Please stand now as we confess our faith and hear God's word of forgiveness. Saints, we gather in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus Christ our Lord, let us with confidence draw near to God, that we may receive mercy and find grace in time of need. Have mercy on us, O God, according to your loving kindness.
In your great mercy, wash away our iniquity and cleanse us from our sin. Create in us clean hearts and renew a right spirit within us. Restore us to the joy of your salvation and sustain us with your Holy Spirit.
Amen. We take a moment for personal, private confession. Saints of God, in the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you, and for his sake, God forgives you all your sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives power to become the children of God and bestows on them his Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Now, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray to the Lord for peace.
Lord, have mercy.
Let us pray to the Lord for salvation.
Lord, have mercy.
Let us pray to the Lord for the well-being of the church and for the unity of the church of God.
Lord, have mercy.
Let us pray for this holy house as we offer God our worship and praise.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. be seated for the Word of God.
The first reading is from Ezekiel chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. He said to me, "Son of man, stand up on your feet, and I will speak to you." As he spoke, the Spirit came into me and raised me to my feet, and I heard him speaking to me. He said, "Son of man, I am sending you to the Israelites, to a rebellious nation that has rebelled against me. They and their ancestors have been in revolt against me to this very day. The people to whom I am sending you are obstinate and stubborn. Say to them, 'This is what the sovereign Lord says,' and whether they listen or fail to listen, for they are a rebellious people, they will know that a prophet has been among them." Here ends the first reading. The second reading is from 2 Corinthians chapter 12. "I must go on boasting. Although there is nothing to be gained, I will go on to visions and revelations from the Lord. I know a man in Christ who, 14 years ago, was caught up to the third heaven. Whether it was in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that this man, whether in the body or apart from the body, I do not know, but God knows, was called up to paradise and heard inexpressible things, things no one is permitted to tell. I will boast about a man like that, but I will not boast about myself, except about my weaknesses. Even if I should choose to boast, I would not be a fool, because I would be speaking the truth. But I refrain, so no one will think more of me than is warranted by what I do or say, or because of these surpassingly great revelations. Therefore, in order to keep me from becoming conceited, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me. But he said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong.'" Here ends the readings.
Good morning. You having a good summer? Going swimming? Playing in the
lake.
Not really. Playing in the water? Yes. Fun times? All right. So, do y'all know what I have here?
The American flag.
Yes, it's the American flag. And you know, it reminds me of a very special holiday that we are celebrating today. Y'all know what it is?
Yeah, 4th of July.
Yeah, the 4th of July. It's also known as Independence Day.
It's when we became independent and the country that was controlling us, we fought.
Yes, you're right, and we won, and we got our freedom. And so that's what I want to talk about. I want to talk about freedom today.
We got that at our home.
You do?
We don't.
It's very important. Yeah. No, I got to keep mine. I didn't have enough for everybody. So we enjoy all types of freedoms today. We enjoy, well, not only today, everywhere, the freedom to worship and come to church. Uh-huh. The freedom to choose what we want to be when we grow up. The freedom to live where we want to live. And it doesn't come free. It comes with a price. So those that serve in the Army or the Navy or the Air Force. She did? Mm-hmm. Or the military or National Guard. They all go and they fight for our freedom. And some of them pay a huge price. Do you know what that is? Mm-hmm. Like happiness in my heart?
Yes.
Yes. When they die for our freedoms and things that we have today.
Like Jesus.
Yes. Look at, you're ahead of me today. You know what's coming. And so that's what I want to talk about next, is the freedom that we have. When we're born into sin, okay? And so when we die, there's a penalty. But Jesus died on the cross for us, and so we are free from that sin. And so rather than just dying, we get to go have eternal life and live with Him. And so He paid the ultimate sacrifice for us that we get to enjoy. So not do we just get to enjoy all the freedoms we have here in our country, but we get to enjoy the great freedom of being free from sin and being able to have eternal life. So today, not only do we celebrate our freedoms that we have in our country, which we talked about, but we also need to remember what God sent us. God sent Jesus so that He could die on the cross for us and that we could have freedom from our sin and live with Him forever.
And when Jesus was on the cross, He was praying to God and was like, I will do whatever you say, but do I have to die?
Yeah, but He did to fulfill God's prophecy. So, all right, let's say a quick prayer. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For the freedom.
For the freedom.
That we enjoy.
That we enjoy.
In our country.
In our country.
We are thankful.
We are thankful.
For those.
For those.
Who paid the price.
Who paid the price.
For our freedom.
For our freedom.
But even more.
Even more.
Important.
Important.
We thank you for.
We thank you for.
The freedom.
The freedom.
We have.
We have.
Because Jesus.
Because Jesus.
Was willing.
Was willing.
To pay.
To pay.
The penalty for our sins.
The penalty for our sins.
Amen.
Amen.
All right. Y'all have a happy 4th and a happy week.
Let's go my hair.
Oh, it looks good today. I think you dropped your bracelet. Luna?
Is from St. Mark, the 6th chapter, beginning at verse 1.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus went away from there and came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. And on the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astonished, saying, "Where did this man get these things? What is the wisdom given to him? How are such mighty works done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, and brother of James, and Joses, and Judas, and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. And Jesus said to them, "A prophet is not without honor except in his hometown and among his relatives and in his own household." And he could do no mighty work there except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and healed them. And he marveled because of their unbelief. And he went out among the villages teaching. And he called the 12 and began to send them out 2 by 2 and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He charged them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not put on 2 tunics. And he said to them, "Whenever you enter a house, stay there until you depart from there. And if any place will not receive you and they will not listen to you, when you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them." So they went out and proclaimed that people should repent, and they cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and healed them. And this is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. In Washington, D.C., on the Capitol building, there's a statue. Now, that Capitol building was, the cornerstone was laid in 1793, and, you know, through the years, it went through many kind of expansions. It actually got burnt down a bit during the War of 1812 and rebuilt. But in 1863, a bronze statue was placed on top of the building, and that statue is sometimes called the Freedom Lady. It stands about 20 feet tall. It's kind of a classical Greek statue of a woman in flowing robes with the sword and all of that stuff. But it is a statue that stands for liberty. Now, that statue was sculpted in Rome and was brought to America on a sailing ship. And during the trip across the Atlantic Ocean, apparently a fierce storm developed, and the ship was in trouble, so the captain ordered that cargo be thrown overboard to lighten the load. Well, things got really bad, and the soldiers wanted to throw the statue of the lady overboard as well. But the captain refused. Shouting over the wind, he said, "No, never. We'll flounder before we throw freedom away." And so freedom was saved, and the statue stands above the dome today because this one man decided to stand for freedom. I think all of us understand that freedom is a good thing. We value it, and we want to stand for it. And freedom is precious, isn't it? But you know, as I was thinking about this, it seems to me that freedom is also precarious. That is, it's something that can be easily lost. And there are two ways you can lose freedom. In the political or civil realm, one of the ways you can lose your freedom is when somebody stronger than you takes it away from you, right? Think of when the Nazi Party came to power in Germany. Between 1933 and 1939, they legislated over 400 national and regional laws that were enacted to marginalize the Jewish people. Jews were excluded from civil service. Jewish doctors were not allowed to serve non-Jewish patients, and they were not allowed to receive money from insurance funds, and Jewish students were not allowed to enter medical school. Jews weren't allowed to marry non-Jewish people any longer. Jewish business were Aryanized, that is, Jewish workers and managers were first fired, and non-Jews were hired, and then eventually Jewish owners were, basically their businesses were taken away from them and given to non-Jewish people. Jews weren't allowed to vote or to hold public office. And you know that the storyline gets even worse, doesn't it? Because after the war began, we all know what happened. The Jews were stuffed into cattle cars, shipped to concentration camps, and killed by the millions. In the civil sphere of human rule, the strong dominate the weak. And I can tell you that when political and governmental power dehumanizes people, like the Nazis did in Germany, and diminishes their freedom and takes it away, the only result that can come out of that is bad things, right? Because at the very least, the people who are dehumanized, the people who have had their freedom taken away, can only feel anger and bitterness in their hearts. And that pain of that wound can fester and fester and fester. So it's the kind of wound that can fester for generations in the souls of people and then flare up again in vengeance to start a new cycle of hatred and violence all again. Quite frankly, part of what America is experiencing is what? The festering wound of American slavery and the genocide of the Native Americans. Even it's 200, 300, 400 years down the road, still lives. And now it's starting to come forth, and we see that the pain is being expressed in anger, and that the desire for rectifying what was done is to kind of create the same kind of circumstances, only on the other side, to flip it over. And see, here's the thing about political freedom. In the world of sin, where there is no gospel, there's only power, it's like the wind that just blows around and around and around. First, this fella is in charge, and then later that fella who takes his vengeance and in charge. And if you read world history, you know all over the place this is what happens, right? Nations rise and fall, leaders rise and fall. I have to laugh in the medieval ages. At one point, the Pope could dispose the king. He was so powerful. 150 years later, the king could depose the Pope. So these things just go round and round and round. And peace and perfection and human flourishing are hard to come by politically because, well, it's all about power and what's in it for me in the end when it comes to the human sinful nature. So you and I live in this kind of world, but we are Christians. And you know that we have a dual citizenship. Yes, we have our love and our loyalty for our country, our nation, and our families. But we also, as Paul reminds us, have a citizenship in heaven. We're not just Americans, we are the church. And as the church, with that dual citizenship, we have other things to think about and other goals we are trying to reach. So, for example, as church, wherever we live, whether we're Christians in China or Christians over in Ethiopia or Christians in Brazil or America, doesn't matter, wherever we live, Christians are called to be people of peace who seek to do good to all people. That is our calling as Christians. We are called to pray for our leaders and to pray for the prosperity of the nation in which we dwell. We are called to be good stewards of God's creation who care for one another and things within the creation. And we are called especially to take care of those who can't take care of themselves. See? We are called to be salt and light for God. So we live in these two worlds, and sometimes it's difficult when freedom starts to clash among the groups. When this party and that party are wrestling with one another to gain control and power over the other, what do we Christians do? Well, I think in our current moment of political unrest and moral degradation, our calling as citizens of heaven has to trump our calling as citizens of the nation. Because in the end, what we bear as the church are the eternal things that you're not going to get out of any political party or any government anywhere. We are so important to the world because we are the salt in the light of God. And so our calling is to overcome evil with good and to stand firm in the day of evil by holding forth the word of God. And all of what I've said right there, I could send you to Bible verses. I mean, that's our calling, to be the salt and the light of God in the world as the church. That's our high calling. Christian nationalism on the political right and Marxist revisionism on the political left, both are sounding and acting like bullies right now. And we know what bullies do. Our call as the church is to live as the body of Christ in the world. Rather than capitulating to one side or the other, our call is to actually be even more church than we've been. To be the kind of place where people are honored and loved and served because they belong to God. And even our Declaration of Independence reminds us that people are created equal and endowed by God, their Creator, with rights like life and liberty, which should not be taken away. So in this moment, when you think about freedom, things are getting kind of wonky. What are we going to do? I tell you what we're going to do. We're going to be the church. And the world needs the church to show it how to live, to show it how to truly do freedom that works. Now, because we are not perfect, it doesn't always happen. And because we are not perfect, it's not easy. And because we are at the whims of the powers that be in the world, sometimes we get crushed. Remember, Jesus reminds us that we are like sheep among the wolves. But again, our high calling is to be citizens of heaven above all. So one way you lose your freedom is in the political realm, when the bully takes it away from you. And yes, we need to be strong so that when that comes, we, knowing who we are, can say no. I tell you, we talked about this a little bit in Bible class. I wonder if World War II could have been prevented had the Christian church in Germany stood up to the Nazi party and said no. God doesn't call us to race hatred. But it didn't. 70% of Lutheran pastors became Nazi Party members, apparently, and wore the brown shirt. And because of that, 65 million plus people died around the world. Well, let's go on. The Bible talks about freedom in another way, doesn't it? It talks about freedom in terms of our spiritual relationship with God. And there's a second way to lose your freedom. Not only if the bully comes and takes it away from you, but you can actually throw your own freedom away by your actions, by your behavior. This happens, of course, when we step outside the boundaries of the freedom which God has given us to pursue in order to obtain the illusionary better freedom of sin. Now, let me use an analogy here so this makes sense. Think of a kite flying in the sky. It's up in the air. It's tethered by a string. It's borne about by the winds, going this way and that and swooping and swishing. And oh man, that's a lot of fun when you have a nice windy day and you're flying a kite, right? As long as the wind is blowing, the kite can fly for hours. But what happens if you cut the string? Well, for a brief moment, the kite may fly faster and higher and further when you cut the string, but eventually, and often quite quickly, what happens is the kite begins to lose the shape of a sail when you cut that string, and it begins to collapse on itself, and it loses the wind, and then it plummets to the ground and is destroyed, right? We were made by God to be kites that fly in the wind of His divine goodness. We are tethered to God by His good and gracious will. When we live in accord with the Ten Commandments and the Holy Spirit of God influences our lives, we can enjoy the thrill of faithful and fruitful, loving and peaceful living. We can trust that God will keep His watchful eye on us and keep hold of us by His tether so that we can prosper in peace. But cut the tether of any one of those Ten Commandments, or forget that you live by the wind of God's Spirit blowing in your life, or ignore the good book that gives us godly direction. Do any of those things, then what should you expect to happen? The loss of your freedom and destruction that comes when we are sold in slavery to sin. So, yes, man, that act of adultery may have been great fun for a short while, but the ruination of your marriage and destruction of your children isn't, right? Or, yes, that silent theft from the company all those years may have allowed you to drive better cars and take nicer vacations, but you're not going anywhere when you're thrown in prison, right? And yes, turning away from the church and abandoning your prayers may seem a great relief when you're finally out of your parents' sight and out of the control of the church, but I can tell you when the day of trouble comes calling, and it will for all of you at various ages, when the day of trouble comes and all you can do is call out to God and seek for His help because you have no control over the circumstances that are destroying you, how will you mount up and fly with wings of faith again if you've already crashed your kite? See? St. Paul says in Galatians chapter 5, "For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery." And he's talking about sin. Then in verse 13, he says, "You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love." Christians guard their behavior and take sin seriously, not because they want to drag themselves and others through the mud, but because they know that the only way to experience true inner spiritual freedom of the soul is to fly tethered to the hand of God. Living outside of God's will, no matter how inwardly freeing it may seem in any moment, means living in a way that is eventually directed toward your destruction, whether it's here on earth or even hell in the age to come. So no, don't throw your freedom away because for a moment it seems better. Now I want to close with this final thought. On July 8th, 1776, that would be 4 days after the Independence Day, the Liberty Bell, we read about that in school, right? The Liberty Bell up there in Pennsylvania rang out from the tower of Independence Hall, summoning citizens to hear the first public reading of the Declaration of Independence by Colonel John Nixon. freedom is one of those things so valuable to humanity, so valuable to our own souls, that it deserves a liberty bell to ring out and declare it for all to hear. To bring attention to the freedom which God has given, right? To proclaim that this is good and worth having. St. Paul writes in Romans 3:24, by the free gift of God's grace, all people have been put right with God through Jesus Christ, who has set them free. The gospel of Jesus Christ is our liberty bell, right? If we want people to be saved, if we want them to be influenced by the goodness of God, if we want the moral and political culture of our nation to return to health so that we can live without constantly being bullied, without constant political strife, then the church must do what the church is called to do, which is to ring the liberty bell of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We are called to proclaim freedom in Jesus to the world. So, my friends, I don't know how you fix the nation. I don't know how you make political freedom work. When I look at world history, I just see the wind chasing the wind, chasing the wind. What I do know, though, is the calling we have in Christ Jesus, and I hope that you feel that deeply in your souls. You are called to be Christ's person. You are called to be part of the church. You are called to be a people who know freedom and understand freedom on the inside because you've been tethered to God by the gospel. And you are called to be people then to share that freedom with others. And to the degree that we can convert one soul after another to Jesus Christ, where they can get right in here, then all the better for the world outside of the church, as more and more of us live the true freedom that comes in the Lord. Because quite frankly, if you're in the Lord, you love the Lord, you know the Lord, and you understand the freedom the Lord has given you, you have no desire to be a bully to anyone, right? What do we do in this time, in this age? I read a lot of stuff. I read a lot of commentators making suggestions, this, that, and the other. I think right now, best advice that I can give you is what I've just given you. If you love freedom, then love the church and be the church, because the freedom of heaven is found there, and that freedom can make a difference in people's lives and even then in political parties. In the name of Jesus, amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, you alone are free, and you give us freedom from sin, O Lord, and we thank you for that, and we pray that you would keep us always faithful to that freedom, O Lord, in our hearts, and then teach us, O Lord, how to live that freedom out in our lives and in the lives of this nation the very best we can under your care. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, friends, let us rise and let us sing together, O God, our help in ages past.
Shadow.
Together our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried.
He descended into hell.
On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Okay, in our prayers today, I don't remember if she made them last week. I want us to lift up Melissa Blackard. She had some surgery on her spine, some kind of fusion, and you know, she's got four kids, and this is pretty serious surgery, so some pain, lots of recovery needed, and need some strength and help to get through this difficult time. Let us go to the Lord. O God, you alone are a free being, bound neither by external power or circumstance, nor inner compulsion or desire. Your every choice is good and wise, and the works of your hand are to be praised. Help us to understand that you have created the human race for fellowship with you, and desire our love to be freely given as you so freely love us. Give us wisdom to see that because you have made every person by an act of your free will, they are worthy of our honor and respect as the work of your creative hand. Preserve us, O Lord, from the hatred of others so prevalent in our world today. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O God, your Son has redeemed us from sin and death and set us free from destructive and fearful lives. Help us to understand that our freedom in Christ opens space for us to serve you with true hearts and loving devotion, and gives us opportunity to serve our neighbors in their various needs. Keep us free from the power of sin, that we may continuously serve you with pure and joyous hearts. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O God, your Holy Spirit has raised up in every generation the body of Christ that lives scattered among the nations. Prosper your church in every nation, and receive our thanksgiving for allowing your church in this nation the freedoms to assemble and worship and give witness to the gospel of Jesus Christ. And be with those Christian communities who enjoy no such freedoms, and grant them strength from on high as they suffer for their faith. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O God, on this day of political independence, we thank you for the freedoms guaranteed in our Constitution, And we ask that those freedoms be preserved among us for all the citizens of this nation. As Christian people, help us to honor the powers that rule over us, to pray for their well-being, to encourage all men to peace, and to be faithful witnesses to your word and divine justice in the public square. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Hear our prayer, O God, for our sister Melissa. Heal her swiftly and completely that she may be strengthened once again to fulfill her duties as a mother. Continue to grant that the Blackard family receive the help and the assistance they need at this difficult time. And hear our prayer for David Daniels, Sarah Smith, Libby Height, Emily Pigman, Michael Wright, and all now whom we name before you in our hearts. Grant to all whom we have prayed for the grace of your presence and the power of your healing touch. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Hear our prayers also, Lord, for Daniel and Mary Dasher, Ruby and Earl Newrath, Audrey Zipperer, Dorothy Zipperer, Virginia DeSalvo, and all our seniors who put their trust in you. Continue to be their rock and salvation all the days of their lives. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O God, as the Apostle Paul learned, that it is in weakness that your power is perfected in us, so in this most humble meal of bread and wine, help us to discern the presence of your Holy Son, who gives himself to us for salvation, for fellowship, and for peace. Lord, in your mercy, into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. At this time, we bring the offerings forward. So with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Then after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. Do this as often as you drink it for the remembrance of me." Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
body and blood of our Lord, preserve you in the true faith and the life everlasting. Amen. Receive now this blessed food and drink.
We ask you to deliver us from every evil. Teach us to love you perfectly and make us one holy church, doing the good works you desire us to do. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him through the power of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Serve the